Hi, I'm Kurt David, host of the show From Glory Days. Please join me and watch the stories of Hall of Fame, All-Star, World Champion, and former professional athletes as they've transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back to normal, everyday lives. Today's guest grew up in Flint, Michigan. By his senior year in high school, he was ranked one of the nation's top 10 basketball forwards. He led his Michigan State University team to an NCAA national title in the year 2000, and his lengthy NBA career had him sporting uniforms in Toronto, New Orleans, and Oklahoma City. In 2013, our guest was inducted into the Michigan State University Athletic Hall of Fame. Today's guest, Morris Mopete Peterson. When we come back, you'll hear Mopete explain why he now prefers art over basketball.
From Glory Days, with your host, Kurt David.
Professional athletes give everything to win the game. After their glory days, most professional athletes want to give back to their communities. United Athletes Foundation helps athletes focus on their visions and support causes that are important to them. With a remarkable background and impressive stats, Great Lakes Capital Fund is the perfect teammate capable of making big things happen. With this team, everyone wins.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
I'm Kurt David. I'm joined today by Morris Mopete Peterson, NCAA champion and NBA veteran. Morris, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks for having me.
So basketball in your life, actually sports in your life, was something that you grew up with. You had family members, your mother, your father, your sisters. Tell us what it was like growing up with a family full of collegiate athletes.
Oh, man. It was so competitive. Man, my sisters got scholarships, D1 scholarships. One of my sisters, Trina, won a state championship. My other one scored 42 points in high school. So I'll tell you what, I mean, even from day one, I mean, we were always competing to see who can get out the car the fastest and get in the house. And that's where it started for us, you know. And even my parents, they just always encouraged me, to go outside and be active, and that's
participate. And yeah, both
yes.
parents played collegiately as well, and
yes.
your sisters, and
yes,
and the state championship, you weren't able to ever top that as far as the high school, were you?
No, I wasn't. And my sister, I hear that almost every
still
day.
Still a contention, isn't it?
Yes.
Well,
it
the
is.
Good news is that the story moved on though from high school, that you had opportunity to play. Why Michigan State?
Well, I mean, Michigan State always had a great tradition. You know, I grew up watching Magic, Steve Smith, and those guys, and but I followed Michigan basketball, you know, in general, you know, even University of Michigan mm-hmm. and you know Michigan State. And but one thing that that kind of got me about Michigan State was how close everybody was. Coach Izzo from day one was kind of like a family. You know, he you know was very upfront with me as far as recruiting and said, Morris, you know, it's going to be hard. It's going to be a battle, but you know, if we do everything how we're supposed to do it, we can win a championship. And and also Antonio Smith, I wanted to play with one of the best power forwards, and he just happened to be my best friend. So he wouldn't let me go anywhere else anyway.
You had quite a group from Flint, actually. It was
yes.
more than just there was more of you there, the guys that played along. And you got to Michigan State, had great success at Michigan State. Let's
you.
Talk about those years.
Some of the best years of my life. I'm still pinching myself. I went down to March Madness a couple of days ago, and just the atmosphere and to be able to win a national championship and play for such a prestigious school and be at home. You know, I had a lot of different scholarship offers mm-hmm. in other states, but it's just something about being home and it made
and
it
do it here
special.
In Michigan while you were here. Yeah.
Yes.
So tell us about that moment, winning a national championship. Obviously, I think in my opinion, probably yours as well, that trumps a high school championship of your sister, right? You were able to get through that.
Not according to my sister.
Okay. But what was it like for you to win that championship?
It was amazing. It was amazing because I remember the nights when Mateen and I would, you know, it's 12 o'clock at night, 1 o'clock in the morning, we sitting there and say, hey, let's go get some shots up. You know, I'm pulling him out the bed and, you know, all the, you know, sweat and the tears and the ups and downs. And then once you realize that this is what it's all for, it was just so gratifying.
All that hard work had paid off, yes. in other words. Only
yes.
one team finishes on a win.
Yes.
And you were it that year, 2000. Yes. Mm-hmm. So it went from there, though. You had an opportunity, you got the draft, had a great success in Toronto early on.
Well, my first NBA game, I look across and who am I playing against? Mateen Cleese, my first NBA game. So here's a guy who we, you know, in elementary school, he's the first person I saw stepping into a game, organized game. Mm-hmm. So got him, won a national championship, graduated from college, did all these things together. Now we playing our first NBA game. So it was.
What was that like? What was that like playing against each other?
Well, a few times I caught myself kind of cheering for him a little bit. He made a shot and I had to remember who I was playing for.
He's on the other side now.
Yes, yes, he is. It was a great experience, you know, just to step out on the court and, you know, everything's moving so fast and you just want to soak everything up. And I catch myself a lot of times, you know, think about memories, think about times where it was kind of going fast then, but just sit back and say, wow, that happened.
The glory days, so to speak. Yes. Well, tell about 11 years in the NBA. What kind of memories do you have? What of playing? What were some of the best memories?
Some of the best memories, I would say, is the relationships I had with a lot of my teammates and being able to form those relationships for life, to be able to play with some of the best players in the world. Mm-hmm. Lenny Wilkins, one of the greatest coaches and players. I got a chance to play for him my rookie year, my first couple of years, and you get a chance to learn from some guys who've been around, you know, who had some longevity in their career, and that was important for me.
Yeah, and you learn quick, all rookie team, right? All rookie team your first year, came in, made an impact. In 11 years, you played in a couple different teams. What were some of the best memories that you have in cities, with players? What were some of the best things that you recall?
Oh, well, Toronto.
So many of them, right? There is, yeah.
Well, yeah, I played for three teams, mm-hmm. and Toronto, all the teams were special because, you know, getting drafted in Toronto, was, I don't know what to expect, and, you know, I got guys who I've been looking up to, and now I'm playing with them.
Mm. They were heroes growing up and people you modeled after. Yeah.
I mean, I collected their basketball card, now I'm playing with them. So to get a chance to play in Toronto, to get a chance to play in New Orleans after the storm, and, you know, to see the impact that you could have just by, you know, playing a game of basketball. It kind of brought everyone together. So it was such a blessing. And then when I got to Oklahoma City, I got a chance to play with Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook and those guys. And I'll tell you what, I haven't seen a bunch of guys who love the game collectively as much as I've seen them.
Some great talent you had there, no question about it. Well, we need to take a quick break here. We need a break for a commercial, but when we come back, Mo Pete will tell us the funniest thing he's ever done to coach Tom Izzo.
From Glory Days, presented in part by Janosco Development Company, building a brighter future today.
Great Lakes Capital Fund has built a game plan to provide a legendary kind of impact that will facilitate affordable housing to those in need and help build and better the communities that surround them. Together, the United Athletes Foundation and the housing and development experts at Great Lakes Capital Fund have the power of connecting professional athletes' vision, voice, and drive with asset management and strength. With this team, everyone wins.
Big statements are made with actions, not words. Go to the guys that work as hard as you do. Nowatzky Truck and Trailer on US 23, exit 149 in Whitmore Lake. The 24,000 square foot facility performs all service applications on tractors and trailers, light duty, heavy duty, single axle, multi-axle, dump trailers, and walking floors. No job is too big or too small. Nowatzky Truck and Trailer, 734-995-9600. Nowatzky Truck and Trailer. We do it right the first time.
Do you need a proven winner? Do you want to build a better team, create stronger leaders, and face change like a champion? Kurt David works with highly successful individuals, organizations, and businesses that at times face challenges with leadership, change, and developing passion. Go to KurtDavid.com and allow Kurt the opportunity to work with you.
Janosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
I'm Kurt David, joined today by Mo Pete, NCAA champion, NBA veteran. We ended up that last segment with the funniest story. What's the funniest thing that you've ever done to coach Tom Izzo?
Well, I wouldn't say too much because I spent a lot of time in a doghouse.
Oh. So there wasn't a whole lot of funny going on between you and him. You had to keep things straight?
A few times, yeah. Well, you know, Coach, the thing is, he would always challenge us to free throws. He thinks he's a free throw champion. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he always bragged about how he hit 100-some free throws in a row. So every day he would challenge guys. And it's funny because, but guys got better throughout the year. That helped me get better.
Did you ever beat him?
Oh, always.
Oh, okay.
All the time. Coach, you never beat me. I'm just letting you know that.
Yeah, so that's funny in itself right there. Back to, we talked about the NCAA championship. We talked about playing professional for 11 years. Mm-hmm. At what point did you start realizing that this game is kind of getting away from me? I'm going a different direction. How did that happen for you?
Well, my parents, growing up, you know, they were teachers, so they always taught me the importance of having a plan B. Mm-hmm. You know, I would always say I'm going to the NBA, mm-hmm. but my mother would say, hey, you know, you got to get your grades and get your education first. And always have a plan B. So going into that, I knew going into the NBA, I didn't know if I was going to play 5 years, 10 years, 2 years, you never know. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to find something that I liked doing, and I loved cars. And I started my first business when I was 24. I had a car customization shop and a leasing company. Mm. And, you know, we had it for a few years. We had a couple guys. Andre Iguodala got some customization work from us, Jalen, and a bunch of different guys. So
that was your plan B at that time, customizing and everything? Yeah,
I was going to hook the guys up with their rims and their stereo systems. Mm-hmm.
Did that continue to be plan B for you?
Well, it turned into my love for, you know, starting businesses and stuff, mm-hmm. and really feeling, you know,
entrepreneurial
spirit. And from there, you know, I've just been able to do things over the years. But I didn't know how long I was going to play. So that was one of my first ventures. And I always kind of had that in the back of my mind that, you know, if I get hurt or something happens,
you need something to back up.
I have enough money and I have enough, have something that I like doing.
So let's talk about that. At what point then did you realize I'm done as an NBA player?
Well, when I was sitting at home after I got cut, mm-hmm. After I got traded from Oklahoma City to Charlotte, and I never had to report. You know, it was just a business
paper thing, trade.
Paper trade. Mm-hmm. So after that, I just kind of knew that hey, this may be the end. This, you know, I may, but also, you know, I ended up having kids, and I never really had a chance to spend a whole lot of time with my family throughout the years.
And you're traveling, you're busy with games and working out and everything like that. So that was the first chance with that time was valuable to you at that point as well.
Yes.
So it got quiet. You said you got released and then things got really quiet that you didn't get the phone calls and you started thinking about, boy, this is it.
Yeah, it is. But before then, I started a transportation company in Miami. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I got a couple permits. I wanted to start a business and I really did the research and found the right people to put in place that
for
things
success.
That I didn't know. And I've been doing it for 5 years. Mm. You know, since then I've been able to expand. We're about to expand to Toronto. We're expanding to here in Michigan in a few months. So I'm excited about that.
So what were the downside? What was the difficult part for you leaving the NBA, leaving as a player? What was the difficult part for you?
Well, just the playing and the camaraderie with the team. And, you know, being in a locker room, mm-hmm. that's something that, you know, over the years you get used to. And then all of a sudden you're not in
that bonding like that, of accomplishing a goal and a mission.
Yes.
Have you found anything to replace it?
Well, I spent a lot of time with my kids. Mm. But also I started a clothing line as well, World Artist Refuge. That's a nice shirt you have on.
Yeah, thank you so much.
I started that company about a year ago because I want to bring some jobs back to Flint, back to Michigan. You know, you look at the economy and everything that's happened over the years, it's, you know, been going down. And even though things are starting to get better a little, you know, gradually, I think it's important to
you
bring
look
back.
How to improve that even better. Absolutely. So you mentioned about your kids a couple times here. You've had two sets of twins, not just one set of twins. You have two sets of twins.
Yes.
How did that help you transition out of as a player?
Well, my parents, you know, they were very supportive of me. They went to almost every game, even in college, growing up. And that's important to me. That's important to be around, you know, my children. And kind of had to make a decision saying, hey, you know, do I want to take this time to get back in shape, and Or do I want
to get picked up somewhere or find a place to play? And,
I have been fulfilled basketball-wise as well. You know.
In what way?
Got a chance to compete with some of the best players. Got a chance to live out my dream. Nobody thought I would ever go this far. You know, play 11 years. I didn't know if I was going to play 11 years in the NBA.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I got a chance to accomplish some great things and be able to make my family happy.
Did it exceed what you expected? Did you expect more than that or less than that?
It exceeded.
It exceeded.
But I think, you know, if you look at us winning a championship and bringing what we did to the state of Michigan, I think every year it gets sweeter and sweeter for me, because I remember back when Martina and I and all of us would say, hey, we win a championship, you know, we'll be the mayor
top of the world.
Yeah, we'll be the top of the world. We'll always be able to come back.
To Flint and own it.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah.
So, but now we look at it and say, man, that was a great accomplishment, because we've made so many people feel good.
Yeah.
You know, and follow the game of basketball. I still have people, whenever I travel and go places, they say, hey, we were watching you guys.
Special year, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
On that note, we need to take another break. When we come back, Mo Pete is going to explain how he went from professional athlete to professional designer. When we come back.
From Glory Days, presented in part by Genosco Development Company, building a brighter future today.
Great Lakes Capital Fund and the United Athletes Foundation have built a game plan that will create stable and sustainable communities that include affordable housing and economic development opportunities. The United Athletes Foundation helps athletes focus on their visions and support causes that are important to them. And Great Lakes Capital Fund has a superior track record in raising capital and managing communities they invest in. Together, they raise capital to invest in the future. With this team, everyone wins.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Join me, Diana Lewis, and support Detroit Rescue Mission Ministries, which provides emergency shelter, substance abuse counseling, job training, transitional housing, and eventually to those who qualify, a permanent home so they can lead healthy, independent lives. Among those in need, military veterans, women with young children, and families. Please call the number on your screen or go online to drmm.org and donate now.
We all experience financial bumps in the road. It's called life. And when financial challenges pop up, LOC team members are here. We specialize in debt relief strategies for our members. With lower fees and better loan rates, you'll realize the best place to do all your banking is at LOC Federal Credit Union. It's time to own your money. Visit us on the web or call to learn more.
Welcome to LOC Federal Credit Union. How can we help?
Yep, with Xfinity Internet, your family can use all their devices at once. Works anywhere in the house, even the garage.
Max, what's going on?
We're doing a tech startup. We're streamlining an algorithm.
What's Grandpa doing?
Hi.
Shh, Grandpa, you don't want to be an intern forever.
Sorry, Dad, we have to get back to work. We have a deadline.
We're going public!
The fastest in-home Wi-Fi for your entire family. Sign up for the X1 Triple Play and get double the speed. Only from Xfinity.
I'm Kurt David, joined by Morris Peterson. Mo, athletes take a 90% pay cut when they're done playing professionally, sometimes even more. We read about it all the time. We hear about it, bankruptcy, foreclosures, everything like that. What do you think helped prepare you for that transition out of sports?
Well, I think what helped me was having my parents on me, you know, just checking on me, making sure I'm doing the right things. I always wanted to make sure I had, you know, what I made aside, you know, and made sure I can live, you know, how I want to live. And if I start a business venture or something, you know, it's different avenues you can take. Sometimes you don't even have to use your money, you know. So it's different things that you need to do. But over the years, I've just learned that, you know, I didn't know how long I was going to play. Hey, take care of your money, because when you're done, you know, you hear about all these stories about guys who go broke.
Yeah.
And it's just something that I didn't want to do, and I always wanted to have something in place.
What helped you realize that or understand it? You mentioned about your parents, but they never played professionally, so they didn't understand that totally. What helped you as far as understanding how much, what should I do as far as that part of it?
Well, the NBA, they have a lot of programs. Mm-hmm. They have programs in place, and you just have to take advantage of those programs too, because you know, they have experts who can show you what you need to do and stuff. And then a lot of guys don't go to the meetings, or, you know, I was always one of the guys, if it's something that can help me for the rest of my life, I'm gonna go and sit down and talk to them, especially about my money, because you hear a lot of these stories.
And advice is only as good as it is heeded, right? I mean, you get good advice, doesn't matter if you don't take it.
Absolutely.
You took lots of great advice from your parents, family members, other people along the way, and it helped you become a successful businessman. Let's talk about that, because to transition as an athlete is one thing, but the transition now into a businessman is a whole different thing. Like you said, you mentioned about the transportation company, you had people that knew how to do that. That was key, right? Finding people that knew that. Mm-hmm. What else helped you with your business? Let's talk about that side of it now, what you're doing now, and what helps you have success?
Well, I would say it's my approach. I take my same approach that I did playing sports, as far as, you know, trying to be the first one there.
Mm-hmm. Working hard.
Except for the day, I was a little late. But trying to be the...
we got you here, that's the main thing.
Trying to be the first one there, always. Let me see.
What else gives you success in business?
You know what, 90% of it is being, if you have to find the right people who, like I said, who, if you don't know something, you have to find someone who does, who can show you, or take that same approach that I did playing basketball, as far as my work ethic, the discipline, finding what I need to find. Mm-hmm. And if it's something that interests you, you have to be interested too. It can't be something that you try to do and you can't spend some time actually trying to get it to where you want to get to. So.
And you found that now. You found mm-hmm. something that interests you. In fact, it's interested you for most of your life, and that's the arts, the graphics, things of that sort. Mm-hmm. Tell us more about how you're implementing that now into your life.
Well, I bought a building in Flint. I had a vision of, you know, bringing World Artists Refuge to Flint and bringing some jobs. You know, the economy in Michigan was you know, is not, people can't really find jobs like they want mm-hmm. to. You look at Flint, you look at General Motors, it was 80,000 jobs that got mm-hmm. cut. And just trying to help build and bring something to the table. And because I know collectively it's not just going to be me, it's going to be a lot.
You got to build a
people.
Team.
Yes.
Yeah. So tell us more about the World Artist Refuge. What is that? What is it all about?
World Artist Refuge is it's basically a brand. You know, I'm dealing with my foundation. I travel around the world and I meet so many different amazing people, and I just want to bring all that together. You know, and with arts, sports, entertainment, just many different avenues. You know, World Artist Refuge is for everyone.
Mm-hmm. And how do you plan on doing that? The shirts are a start, right?
Getting you to wear.
Yeah, well, I got the shirt on, no question. That helps. So what is it that I think is going to make this successful for you? What is it that's going to take it to the next level?
What do I think is going to take it to the next level?
Yeah, you know what it took to be a player at that next level. What's going to take
I mean, it's going to take that commitment. It's going to take that hard work. It's going to take getting out there and letting people see the brand, see mm-hmm. what we're doing, what we stand for. And you know, I've been out down in Toronto. Everywhere I go, I'm pumping up World Artist Refuge, because if you look at what's happening as far as, let me see, how can I explain this? If you look, it's a refuge. It's mm-hmm. it's a place where I want people to look at World Artist Refuge and say, you know what, I feel good about that interaction, or I feel good about being involved with that foundation mm-hmm. or being involved with World Artist Refuge. And that's what I wanted to be. I wanted to be a good feeling.
Yeah. And where can people find out more about this?
They can log on to worldartistrefuge.com. They can email me at morris@worldartistrefuge. We'll can send you some information. We're about to start our clothing brand officially in the first quarter of next year. Mm-hmm. And that's when we expect to be open and have the building open. It's a 24,000 square foot building. And I'm excited.
Yeah, looking to employ people locally and really build that
Absolutely.
Up and everything.
Absolutely.
Well, we're going to take a little break right now. We need to take another commercial break, but when we come back, we're going to talk more about how Morris dribbles two sets of twins.
From Glory Days, presented in part by Genosco Development Company, building a brighter future today.
Professional athletes give everything to win the game. After their glory days, most professional athletes want to give back to their communities. United Athletes Foundation helps athletes focus on their visions and support causes that are important to them. With a remarkable background and impressive stats, Great Lakes Capital Fund is the perfect teammate capable of making big things happen. With this team, everyone wins.
I'm Kurt David, joined by Morris Mo Pete Peterson. So right before the break, we talked about your kids. They're your pride and joys, two sets of twins. I mean, one set of twins is enough, but two sets of twins. What do your kids mean to you today?
Oh, man, they mean the world to me. Malia, Milani, Morris, and Alina. Each one of them remind me of something about myself.
Which is?
You know, I can't tell you that.
Oh, okay. Good things, hopefully?
I'm joking. You know, Malia is, you know, she kind of reminds me of myself. You know, when I was young, I would try to do everything right, you know, and when if I didn't stack this book up right and it failed, I would get frustrated, you know, just little things like that. It's just kind of funny because to see that part of you.
You recognize that.
Yes, but also I have a third set coming.
A third set of twins.
Third set of twins.
Breaking news on our show.
First time.
Wow. Well, that's great news. Yeah, congratulations.
Thank
so.
You.
So going from two sets of twins to three sets of twins.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's amazing. We're going to have to do another interview after this just to catch up about that. Well, we do have a Facebook question from Paul. And Paul wanted to know, who or what inspired you to stay out of trouble growing up in Flint, Michigan?
Good question. Good question, Paul. I would have to say my uncle. My uncle was a police officer. And he scared the mess out of me, man. He come with his gun and his uniform every day. And just, you know, he wasn't easy on me, you know, and he grew up down south, and he didn't get a chance to pursue his Major League Baseball dreams.
Oh, okay.
And I think because of that, he was extra hard on me.
You know, he wanted to see you. He saw it in you what you could accomplish and everything like that.
He did. My uncle, Alan Davis, yes, he was scary. I mean, even today, I mean, he's still the same. You know, he's retired, but he walks around.
You got that respect. And that kept you in line.
That respect. It does.
Yeah.
It does
keep
you in line. But also, you know, we had places in Flint, you know, people hear about all the places and all the people, all the athletes that come out of Flint, but we had a few places that could keep guys out of trouble. You know, we had Burston Field House, where many of the famous boxers were, and they had a gym. My father was a community school director, so he kept me in a gym.
Other positive outlets for you, and thus basketball became one of the best for you.
Yes.
Well, this show is about the transition of professional athletes and world-class athletes, but more importantly, it's about transitions in life. What advice would you have for anybody that's going through a change or a transition in life?
Well, I would say if you're a professional athlete or you're going through sports and you find yourself at the end of the road, I think it's very important to prepare way before then. You know, you have to prepare like you're not going to play tomorrow. You know, if it's something that you're interested in, you know, read about it. Or if it's something that you may want to transition in, you know, find the right people. Find the people or find guys. For me, I found retired athletes, you know,
to help
me and see, you know, some of the same things that I'm going through.
Yeah, that plan B you talked about earlier. So unfortunately, we're done with our show. Our time is up. I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. Please join us again next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold. From Glory Days.
From Glory Days, presented in part by Genosco Development Company, building a brighter future today.